Open your Bibles with me to Genesis chapter 3 as we study the Word of God today. We've been talking about forgiveness and emotions, and we talked last week about overcoming anger and conquering that in our lives. I want to take you back to the beginning where the problems all began in the world. And you know, if you can get to the root of a problem, then you can stop the fruit of the problem as well. If you just pluck off the bad fruit off a tree, then all you're doing is delaying the inevitable, because the bad fruit is going to keep growing if you don't deal with the root. The Bible says the axe must be laid to the root of the tree if you want to truly cut it down. And the Bible talks about how we will live holy lives as the root is holy. If the root is holy, then all the branches will be holy as well. Too often, a lot of times, people try to live holy on the outside, but they haven't changed their thinking on the inside. They haven't changed the way they look at things. They haven't changed the way they reason through things. They haven't changed the way they react to things on the inside. And so we can try really hard to fix everything on the outside, but it really won't get fixed on the outside till we get to the root of the problem. Jesus is all about getting to the root of the problem. And the root all starts in the Garden of Eden. When God created Adam and Eve, he put them in a perfect world. He made them perfectly holy. He gave them perfect freedom and authority in this life and in this world. And he gave them the absolute best of all of creation. And he put them in the garden and he said, "You have dominion. You have authority over all of the birds of the air, the fish of the sea. You have authority over all the cattle on the earth. You have authority over every creeping thing and everything that creeps on the earth." And isn't that great? We have authority over creeps. Amen. But the Bible says that God gave this authority to Adam and Eve. But what happened was they bought a lie from the devil. They submitted their lives to the devil by listening to his word rather than listening to God's word. How many know when you listen to God's word, you're going to have success? When you listen to the devil's word, you're going to fail. The devil has got failure in his plan for your life. God has victory and success in his plan for your life. Amen. The one who listens to the word of God, the storms can come, the winds can blow, beat against that house, but his house will stand because his house is built upon the word of God. Now, so if we look at what happened with Adam and Eve, I want you to see in Genesis chapter 3, after they ate from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, it says that they started blaming each other. God says to Adam, you know, "Where are you?" And Adam says, "I was afraid," in verse 10 of Genesis chapter 3. He said, "I was afraid, I was naked, and I hid myself." In other words, all of a sudden, now that Adam and Eve have sinned, I want you to see this curse that came into the world. This curse came into the earth. Now they're afraid. So we can see that the first curse of Adam and Eve's sin, or the first curse that came upon the earth, was that now Adam is ruled and dominated by fear. God created him to dominate and to rule the earth, but now he is ruled by fear. He said, "I was afraid, so I hid myself." Notice, he reacted to fear. His actions took on the emotion of fear. He had the emotion of fear, and therefore he hid himself. So his actions reflected his emotions. His emotions were fear, and therefore he hid himself. So if you react to your emotions, and if you allow your emotions to make up your decisions for you, then your emotions are going to ruin your life. What we have to realize is if our emotions rule our lives, then our emotions are going to ruin our lives. Let me say that again. If our emotions rule our lives, then our emotions are going to ruin our lives. Are you with me still? That's why we have to learn how to rule over our emotions rather than allowing them to rule over us. Now, so fear is governing Adam and Eve's life now. "I was afraid, so I hid. I was afraid, so I ran. I was afraid, so I was ashamed. I was afraid, so I reacted. I was afraid, so I hid myself." Now notice what else happens. So fear comes in, and then on the heels of fear, all these other negative emotions begin to take over in Adam and Eve's lives. Notice what it says in verse 12 and verse 11, and he said, "Who told you you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat?" And the man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat." Notice the first two words that came out of Adam's mouth after the Lord said, "Who told you were afraid? Who told you were naked? And have you eaten from the tree that I told you not to eat from?" The woman. The woman. You know, that's the sorriest, weakest, mamsy-pamsy, flimsy-flamsy, banana-back, milk-toast manhood that I've ever seen in my life. For the first words to come out of a man's mouth is he's blaming the woman. "Well, she doesn't treat me right, and that's why I'm into pornography." No, you're into pornography because you haven't got control of that lust. Oh, not a lot of amens on that. All right, that's fine. It's real quiet now. Hey, look, there's no condemnation for those that are in Christ. If you're struggling with pornography, God can heal you and God can deliver you. But don't blame it on the woman. The woman. Be a man. Stop blaming women. Stop blaming anybody for that matter. Right? The woman. Oh, it's so funny. "The woman that you gave me." Blame the woman and then blame God. "She gave me of the tree and I did eat." Do you see this dramatic fall of man? God created man as a conqueror. God created man, he had dominion in the earth. God created Adam and Eve and they ruled the earth and they dominated this world. And they controlled the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and the fowl of the air and the cattle and the animals of the ground. They had complete dominion. He said, "I bless you. Go fill the earth, subdue the earth, and rule the earth." And man, in his dignity under God, ruled the world, ruled the earth. He was the Lord of the garden. He was the Lord of the earth. He was Lord of all of everything else that breathed upon the face of this earth. He was Lord. He was the God of this world, in a sense. Man was, quote unquote, the God of this world. That's why when Satan got Adam and Eve to sin, Satan became the God of this world's system, because he took that authority from Adam and Eve. Are you with me still? But now, this once dominating man, this masculine man, this man of authority, Adam, before he sinned, this man of godliness, this man who walked with God in the cool of the day, this man that named all the animals, this man that had wisdom and creativity, this man that could that had authority and dominion, has now become a blamer. "The woman that you gave me, she made me eat." You wimpy, wimpity wimp. "That's why I did it. That's why I ate." He has been sissified. He has become less than all that God created him to be. Now he's blaming. Now he's afraid. Now he's whimpering. Now he's scaredy cat. Now he's too soft and weak to determine whether he should eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Now he's going to blame everything on his wife and everything on God. And you know what? You never grow, and you'll never be all that God created you to be when you blame anybody for anything that's happening in you, around you, or in your world. Amen. We've got to take responsibility for our lives. We have to take responsibility for our emotions. We have to take responsibility for why we're in the situation that we're in. That doesn't mean that it's always our fault. If you were abused as a child, that wasn't your fault. If you were raped, it wasn't your fault. If your parents were alcoholics and they beat you and they and they raised you in an alcoholic environment, that wasn't your fault. However, even though it wasn't your fault, where you go from here is your responsibility. It wasn't your fault in many cases, but it is your responsibility still of where you're going to go from here. Are you still with me? Or did you go home today? So then God turns to the woman in verse 13. He said, all right, I'll play your little game, Adam. And the Lord said to the woman, what is it that you have done? And the woman said, the serpent. It's the devil. How come you fell into that sin? Well, the devil. I told the story at the earlier service. My sister, she's a year older than me. She was 4 years old. I was three. We lived in Detroit. The next door neighbor came over with a croquet mallet and banged her over the head with the croquet mallet. Her head starts bleeding, and God's healed her, so don't feel sorry for her. She's all right now. Because, you know, this kid, they went to this child. He was, I don't know, was he four or five? Was that Adam Wolf or Mark Wolf? Let's announce it to the world. What was his name? Have you forgiven him, by the way, yet? He hits her over the head, and she's bleeding, and our parents, you know, got together with the kid and his parents next door, and they said, why did you do that? And he said, the devil made me do it. The devil made me do it. Blaming the devil. Really, you were stupid, wrong, selfish, and angry, and you did it. You can blame it all on the devil if you want, but as long as you blame it on somebody, you'll never take responsibility for your life, even if you blame it on the devil. And don't get me wrong, the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy, and he is the root of many of our problems and many of our issues, but we have authority over the devil, so we can't blame him anymore. We can't say, well, it's because of the devil anymore, because Jesus conquered the devil, Jesus overcame the devil, and he gave you authority, and he gave me authority, and he gave us dominion over all the darkness and the rulers of this world. And the Bible says in Luke chapter 10, verse 19, it says, behold, I give you authority. Jesus said to us as Christians, behold, I give you authority to trample upon serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Amen. Nothing shall by any means hurt you. That's the kind of authority that we have in this world now. We have authority over anger. We have authority over fear. We have authority over depression. We have authority over our emotions. And if we don't take authority over ourselves, we will seek to take authority and control over others. And God has created us to take control over our own lives, not somebody else's life. Amen? Weak people seek to control somebody else. But people that take personal responsibility seek to control their own appetites, their own desires, their own emotions, and their own actions. And we need to be people who take responsibility. As I shared with you last week, Proverbs 16, verse 32, better is a man who can rule over his anger than the mighty, and better is a man who can rule his spirit than one who captures an entire city. That's us. That's you. You are the man or the woman that can rule your spirit. You are the man or the woman that can take control over your emotions. Can you say amen to that? And then he says, unto the woman, in verse 16, he said, I will greatly multiply your sorrow and your conception. In sorrow you shall bring forth children. And your desire shall be to rule over your husband, but he shall rule over you, as we talked about that. But I want you to see this in verse 17. He said, and sorrow shall control your life. Now, I want to, as we continue to unfold this topic of our emotions, and we continue to peel back the onion and get to the root of the issues in our lives, we need to see that after Adam and Eve sinned, several things took root in their lives. After they fell and ate from the tree God told them not to eat from, they were afraid. They began to blame others. They became irresponsible and blame shifting. And then here he says in verse 16, they became full of sorrow or sadness or depression. He said you're going to have sorrow at conception and you're going to have sorrow and pain when you bring forth children. So not only will you have sorrow giving birth to the child, he said you'll have sorrow raising the child. And anybody who's had kids knows that it's one thing to have a child. You've gone through some pain in giving birth to that child. But then as you raise that child, that can be pretty painful too. Anybody have any kids here? But that's the curse. The curse upon Adam and Eve after they sinned was that they would be ruled by their emotions rather than being those who had authority and dominion over their emotions. They ended up being ruled by fear, by blaming others, by sorrow and depression and sadness, and then by trying to dominate one another. Your desire shall be to rule over your husband, but he shall rule over you. That's this sense of inferiority. So you'll feel inferior. So in an attempt to compensate for your feelings of inferiority and inadequacy, you're going to try to make yourself feel bigger and better than somebody else. And that happens in the world. That happens every day in this world, that people are constantly trying to feel better and bigger than somebody else so they can feel better about themselves. But God didn't create us to have to compete with other people to feel better about ourselves. That's the curse. Inferiority is a curse. It's a curse of emotions. Inadequacy, it's a curse of emotional domination, that where our emotions are dominating us. Now listen to me. Having emotions is not a curse. But your emotions controlling you, that's the curse. That you're controlled by anger. Hey, look, all of us have been mistreated. But not all of us have to respond, and none of us have to respond when we're mistreated. We don't have to get back at somebody. We don't have to get revenge on somebody. All of us have grown up with pain. All of us have grown up with some sort of dysfunction in the junction. Are you with me? All of us have had some funk in our trunk, right? But that doesn't excuse us from being controlled by those feelings. If we all lived by our feelings, we would have killed people by now, if you haven't already. And if you have, you know, please turn yourself in or get in a witness protection program or do something. Come up for prayer, whatever we can do, because we want you to be able to be healed and changed. But the point is you know what I'm saying here, is that if we followed our feelings every time we feel something, we would be simply reacting continually to every problem that we ever face, and we would be under the control of everything that ever happens around us. Because somebody mistreats you, and you have this impulse of anger, or you have this impulse of revenge, or you have this impulse of hatred, and you have this impulse of getting back at somebody, like Cain, who killed his brother Abel because he felt so inadequate on the inside. And we don't have time to get into that today, but if time permits another time, we'll break that down in Genesis chapter 4, because Adam and Eve had Cain and Abel, and Cain killed Abel because he got angry because God accepted Abel's offering but didn't accept Cain's offering. And I have a whole teaching on that we need to get to at some point. But my point in bringing all that up is to say, look at how these people were created by God to rule the earth, and look at how dominated Adam and Eve are now by their feelings and their emotions. Dominated by fear, dominated by sorrow and depression, dominated by anger and sadness, and dominated by inferiority and an inferiority complex. God did not create us to live that way. God created us to dominate our flesh, take control of our emotions, and to rule and reign in this life as joint heirs of Jesus Christ. Amen. How do we get back to that? How do we get back to God's original intention? How do we get over the curse of our emotions? Well, the curse of being emotionally dominated or an emotionally ruled person. You know, the studies show that the statistics have increased to where now one out of every three people are emotionally unstable. One out of every three people are emotionally unstable in some way based on studies and research. One out of every three. You know what that means. That means you got to check your two closest friends, and if they're normal, you're the crazy one, right? Sorrow, sadness, depression, fear, anger, inferiority. Adam and Eve are now completely dominated by their emotions rather than dominating those emotions. And listen, when you can't get control on the inside, you end up trying to control on the outside. And you try to control people. And you try to use your emotions to manipulate or get other people to do what you want them to do, because there's this feeling of inadequacy inside, feeling of inferiority, a feeling of being out of control in here. So you have to take control, or you have to drown those feelings with some addiction, with some lust, with whether it's alcohol or drugs or whether it's people's approval. Some people are addicted to needing other people to like them. How many know what I'm talking about here? We're so worried about what other people think about us. You know, we have to realize that sometimes we have a thought that that person's against us. You might think that person's against you because they looked at you funny, but you don't realize they looked at you funny because they were looking past you. They were looking at something else, or they had a bad pizza that day, and you think, oh, that person's real. Why'd that person look at me like that? Or when somebody cuts you off on the highway, what's that? That person is mad. Why is that person against me? Maybe they're just in a hurry. They're not thinking about you. You know, we think people are thinking about us way too much. And you know that they're not thinking about you. You're thinking about you, but they're not thinking about you. You know, it's funny as we get older. When we're in our 20s, we think about how everybody thinks about us. When we're in our 20s, we're like, worried about what people think about us. When we get to our 40s, we're like, I don't care what people think about me. But when you get into your 60s, you're like, nobody's thinking about me. You finally realize they don't have you on their mind. They have they on their mind, just like you have you on your mind. But we're ruled and dominated by these emotions and these feelings. We talked about anger. Let me just remind you that anger is rooted in basically four things. Number one, anger is rooted in unfulfilled desires. In other words, when you have a need that is not met, it causes you to get angry. When somebody promises to meet a need and then they don't, you get disappointed, and that disappointment turns into anger, or it turns into depression, which is an internal anger towards yourself. So unfulfilled desires. The word anger comes from the same Greek word as we get one of the words for lust. It comes from the Greek word orge, as I mentioned last week, O-R-G-E. The word anger and lust come from the same root word. In other words, anger is rooted in lust. I have a need that did not get fulfilled. Now I'm mad about it. I have a desire that didn't get fulfilled. Now it produces anger. And these two feed off of each other, anger and lust, lust and anger. I have a desire for something. That desire goes unmet, so I get angry, and it begins to corrupt me. Or I get angry that somebody mistreated me, like Joseph in prison. Joseph thrown into a pit, and then Joseph was in Potiphar's house, and Joseph could have said, hey, man, the way my brothers treated me, the way Potiphar treated me, I have every right to take Potiphar's wife now that she's making herself available to me. In other words, his anger towards his brothers and his anger towards Potiphar could have resulted in him lusting after Potiphar's wife, but instead, he did not allow his heart to become bitter at what his brothers did to him. He did not allow his heart to become angry at what Potiphar did to him. Therefore, he was not feeding the spirit of lust. Therefore, when opportunity came for him to give in to that lust, he resisted it, and he was capable of resisting it because he wasn't feeding that lust through his anger and resentment and how he deserved to get back for what people had done to him. And so the anger produces lust, the lust produces anger, these two things go together. So anger is a result of, number one, unfulfilled desires, number two, feeling your rights have been violated. When you feel like, I have the right to be treated right, I have the right to be heard, I have the right to be understood rather than misunderstood, I have the right for them to treat me better. When you feel your rights are violated, then you get angry. And the fact is we get so focused on the rights that our flesh has, we miss out on the rights that we have in the Spirit. In the Spirit, we have divine rights from God. And if we will tap into those divine rights from God, we're no longer concerned about our flesh and what our flesh wants and what our emotions want and what our lust wants. Now, when we have more time, next time perhaps, I'll tell you about your rights that you have in Christ. Because when you discover these rights that you have as children of God, you lose your need to demand that your rights be satisfied from others. You no longer need people to treat you right, because you know when you fall, you have the right to get back up according to what Jesus did for you. And when you have the right to get back up, you no longer beat yourself up for falling and for failing. Has anybody ever done that? You fall, you stumble, and you begin to just beat yourself. You feel like you deserve to be punished. Man, I blew it, I fell, I stumbled, I blew it here, I've sinned here. And so what happens is you beat yourself up, and therefore you stay down. What you need instead of to beat yourself up is to lift yourself up and to realize that God lifts you up and God doesn't beat you up and God's not mad at you for falling and you have every right to get up, because the Bible says if a righteous man falls, he gets up seven times. And when you know that you're the righteousness of God in Christ, when you're born again, God gives you the right to get back up when you've fallen. You don't have to stay down and beat yourself up. Pick yourself up. Wipe the dust off and keep moving forward. Amen. Now, I said to you that anger is rooted in unfulfilled desires, feeling your rights have been violated, feeling that anger accomplishes something. James 1:19-20 tells us that it doesn't accomplish the righteousness of God. And anger is rooted in fear. That we're afraid that we're going to miss out on something. We're afraid that we're going to lose something. We're afraid that somebody's going to take advantage of us. Listen, when people take advantage of you, trust God that he will give back the advantage to you. Yes. Listen, I don't know if you heard what I just said, but when people take advantage of you, trust God to give back the advantage to you. People are going to take advantage of you sometimes. But you don't have to take advantage of them or somebody else to get back at them. Trust God that he will give back to you whatever anybody took. Because he's the God of restoration. Amen. He's the God who restores what's been stolen. Amen. Amen. See, this delivers you from fear. Like if you know, no matter what people do to me, God's going to turn it around. Amen. Then when people do stuff to you, you're like, hallelujah. The more you do to me, the more God has to turn around. The more wrong that is done to me, the more right God can bring into my life. Even though you've done me wrong, God's going to make it right. See, now what you do to me can't hurt me, because my trust looks past you. I'm trusting God behind the situation, not you in front of the situation. Anger, depression. Let's talk about that for a moment if we can, because so many people are depressed. As I mentioned to you last week, that they interviewed 10,000 men across the United States, asked them if they had a problem with anger. 95% of them acknowledged that they did. And anger, again, turned inward, becomes depression. And he says here, in sorrow, you're going to live in sorrow. That's a curse. We're redeemed from the curse. We don't have to live in sorrow. We can live in joy. We can live in peace. We can have joy all the time. We can rejoice anyway. Amen. But the Bible speaks here of depression and sorrow in these verses, in verse 16. And I want to talk to you for a moment and mention there are four sources of depression. As I mentioned, there are four sources of anger. There are also four sources of depression. One is hormonal, chemical. It's something physical is happening inside of you. Something in your brain, something in your body, something in your blood system. It's hormonal, it's physical, it's chemical. And there's nothing wrong with treating that medically. We've got to stop being afraid that if we go to the doctor, we somehow are shortchanging our faith. If we use a doctor, that somehow that must prove that we don't really believe God or we're not trusting God for our healing. Well, let me ask you something. If your tooth is rotting, you better go see a dentist. And some people need to see a dentist, but they won't admit it. All they got to do is open their mouth and look in the mirror, and it'll tell them everything they need to know. Go to the dentist. God is speaking. You understand what I'm saying? Now some of us are afraid to smile real big. But listen, we don't feel like it's a threat to our faith because we went to the dentist, do we? Go to the dentist, you get your teeth clean. You go to an orthodontist to get your, if there was a crooked tooth, you get it straightened. You're not saying, well, if I'm really a Christian, if I really have faith, then God will straighten out my tooth. Yes, God will straighten out your tooth, but he wants to use Dr. Goldstein. Or whoever. So if you have a chemical imbalance, don't be afraid to treat it medically. And don't be mad at yourself. Don't beat yourself up. That doesn't mean we should depend upon medication the rest of our lives, because meditation is the best medication. Meditating on God's word is the best form of medicating yourself with God's healing power. Amen. So God's word can produce healing, but while you're getting the healing to show up in your life, go to the doctor if you need to. Don't faith it out and say, I don't ever need to go to the doctor. I mean, look, if you want to do that, that's fine. But we had a lady that came to us one day and she said, well, I have cancer. My husband wants me to go to the doctor, but I'm believing God for my healing. Well, a few months later, she died. We told her, listen to your husband. If your husband's saying to go to the doctor, honor him. And there's nothing wrong with going to the doctor. It's not a sin. Well, you know what? That was a funeral we shouldn't have had to do that year. Are you with me? So number one, depression can be hormonal. Number two, it can be circumstantial. In other words, I'm depressed because of the circumstances that I'm facing right now. Well, how do we react to that? How do we respond to that? The Bible says that in James chapter 1, verse 2, count it all joy when you encounter various trials. James chapter 1, verse 2. Count it all joy when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance, and let endurance have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing, it says in James chapter 1, verse 2 through verse 4. But notice in verse 2, he says, count it all joy when you are facing various trials. Anybody going through a trial right now? Anybody going through many trials right now? I got files of trials. I've got so many in my life. You know what I'm talking about? But he said, look, here's how you deal with various trials and circumstances. You rejoice anyway. Amen. Count it all joy. Man, when a trial hits you, what are you supposed to do? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, that somehow, some way, you're going to provide a way out of this. And somehow, some way, you're going to turn this situation around. You count it all joy when you encounter various trials. But he's not just expecting us to rejoice and be stuck with the problem the rest of our lives. The next thing we're supposed to do after rejoicing is look at what he says in verse 5. He says, now if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all men liberally or generously without reproach, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in faith, verse 6 says, without any doubting, For the one who doubts is like the surf of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. Verse 7, let not that man expect that he will receive anything from the Lord, being a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. But the point here is in verse 5. So when I'm facing these trials that are depressing me, because it can be really discouraging when one trial hits you, then another trial hits you. And you know, the devil does not time these trials out. He doesn't space them out so you can handle them. He hits you hard and fast as much as he can to defeat you, to overwhelm you, to beat you down, and to get you to give up and quit. And that's why when trials hit, your arms need to hit the air, rejoicing and praising. Your mouth needs to hit God with praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I'm going to praise you anyway. But then step two is I'm going to ask God for some wisdom, because even though I'm going to rejoice in the midst of this situation, I'm not staying in this situation. And God has not confined me. God has not confined me to this trial. He can get me through it. So I'm going to ask him for wisdom. And boy, this will set you free. Now, listen to this. Think about this for a moment. When you face all these trials, God gives you, God says to rejoice anyway, so that'll get you through it. That's how we master the emotion of depression when it's circumstantial. We rejoice anyway, but then we don't say, okay, I'm going to rejoice, but I'm stuck with this problem. No, then we ask for wisdom. And the Bible says that God will always give us the wisdom or the way out of the situation. He says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, with every trial or with every temptation, God provides a way of escape. That should give you hope. In other words, no matter what comes against you, you can have hope that there's an escape. There is a way out. Now, look, when people feel depressed and people feel panic and anxious, it's usually because they feel like the room is closing in on them and there's no door, there's no window, there's no ceiling, there's no way out. But God always provides a way out. And you have to face life today knowing and believing. Today, you're leaving here knowing that there is a way out of whatever mess you made or somebody made for you. You might have scrambled your own eggs or somebody might have scrambled them for you, but there is a way out of that mess and the scrambling of your life. Amen. God always provides a way out. Always. So your eggs cracked. So your yolk broke. Poor baby, scramble them. So you got some lemons in life. Squeeze them. Add a little sugar. You got lemonade. Listen, there's always a way out. Rejoice when life is squeezing in on you, when pressure is coming from the left and from the right, from the front and from the back. Praise God. And ask him for wisdom, and then speak God's word. Because God's word is the light. Thy word, O Lord, is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Guess what? The word will become the light. When you speak the word, all of a sudden, the way will light up. It'll be like a runway in the airport when the lights, at nighttime, when the lights are all lit up down the runway, all of a sudden, you'll know how to land that plane and where to land it, because the word is the light and the lamp that will show you the way, and it will open a way where there was no way. It'll open the door that no man can close. It'll create an opportunity that you would have never thought you would have had when you rejoice, when you ask God for wisdom, and then when you speak God's word. Now, I said there were four ways that depression comes in, and the third one, we said that there's, number one was hormonal or chemical. Number two was circumstantial. Number three, historical. In other words, something from your history, something from your past depresses you because you feel guilty or you feel like you keep dealing with this thing over and over again. So there's something about our past that sometimes depresses us. Something we did that we just can't seem to shake. Something we're hiding that we can't seem to let go of or tell anybody about. But God knows, and God has forgiven you, and the blood of Jesus has washed it away. We're not talking about sweeping stuff under the rug. We're talking about there is no rug and there's nothing to be swept because God has wiped it away and washed it away and it never will exist again, and God doesn't remember your sins, because if you trust what Jesus did on the cross for you, your sins are completely washed and they're gone and it's over. Can anybody say amen? So your history cannot control you and make you depressed. You need to, when that depression comes or that sadness or that sorrow comes because you feel guilty about something, you need to remind yourself, I take up my cross. I mean, I take up the cross. Jesus died for this sin. I don't have to beat myself up and live in guilt anymore. Jesus washed it away through his blood. Amen. Hormonal, circumstantial, historical, and demonic. There are demonic reasons why people get depressed and why people struggle in their emotions, because the devil wants you to react in life to your emotions, because when you let your emotions make your decisions for you, you'll make bad decisions, and bad decisions produce a bad life. You see, it's not the bad emotions, it's the bad emotions that produce bad decisions that lead to a bad life. And that's why when you're dealing with your emotions, you got to deal with your thought life, because your thoughts feed your emotions. If you think somebody's against you, you begin to get mad at them. You begin to be resentful towards them. It's the thought that is coming to you, and it's the thoughts that are feeding your emotions. That's why the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5, we're to take every thought captive. We're to get control of our thought life, because the devil is hitting us from every angle with our thoughts to change our emotions, to lead us to make bad decisions so that our lives will be ruined. So what do? We have to take our thoughts captive. Now, how do you take your thoughts captive? Now, we'll close with this concept, but how do you take your thoughts captive? You take your thoughts captive with something greater than your thoughts. And what are those? Let me do an experiment with you real quick. I'm going to ask everybody to do something in your head. I want you to count in your head. Don't say it out loud, but count in your head silently. When I say go, count to 10 silently. Don't go yet, but when I say go, count to 10 silently in your head until I give you your next instruction. Are you ready? Count to 10 in your head. Ready? Go. Now say your name out loud. Hama, hama, hama. Some of you speaking in tongues. I like that. That's good. What happened when you said your name out loud? You stopped counting. In other words, what you were thinking about, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, as soon as you said your name, it silenced your thoughts. Your words coming out of your mouth silenced the thoughts going on in your head. And when you speak God's word, the devil, you got all these thoughts coming to you. You're a failure. You're ugly. You're never going to make it. You're not as good as that person. Your finances are going to crumble. You're not going to pass this test. You're going to fail this. You're going to fail that. People don't love you. People don't like. All these thoughts are going on in your head. And you can silence those thoughts by uttering these words that come from the Bible. When you say, no, I'm not a failure. I'm the head and not the tail. I'm above only and not beneath. God is on my side. God is for me, not against me. Something good's going to happen in my life. The Bible says that I'm more than a conqueror through him that loved me. I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. Greater is he that is in me than he's in the world. You see, what's happening is the voice of God's word silences the thoughts of the devil in your head, because your thoughts are going to produce your emotions are going to produce decisions, and your decisions are going to determine your life. So we cut it off at the root, at the thought life, and we speak God's word. When the devil came to Jesus and said, if you're the Son of God, turn these stones into bread, and Jesus said, it is written. And then the devil came again, and Jesus said, it is written. And the devil came again, and Jesus said, it is written. That's how he got control of his thought life. That's how he silenced the lies of the devil. And that's how you can too. Amen. Amen. Amen? Come on, let's stand together. Let's stand together and let me pray for you.